Call this meeting to order, please. Please rise to the pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic which stands one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Jim Rubens is here tonight, and Jim's been around for quite a while in politics, in New Hampshire politics, for about 20 years or more. He served two terms in the New Hampshire Senate. He earned a voting record of A, rating from the NRA on gun rights. This year he has worked on a proposed constitutional amendment for a balanced budget, term limits, and curbs to federal power. That'd be nice, huh? He's run for governor in 1998. He ran for the U.S. Senate in 2014, and in 2013, Union Leader named him Citizen of the Year. So let's see what his vision is for his run for the U.S. Senate. Jim?
Thank you, Tony. So the cameras, it's okay, I stand here. You can re-aim cameras. I hear you're live streaming. This is great. Thank you. So thank you, folks, for coming out and letting me present myself to you. Jim Rubens here, as mentioned. My website is jimrubens.com, and I'll go through, because I'm a policy wonkish sort of a person, so I've got 14-point plans on about everything I talk about, and it's, thank God, I'm not going to talk about them all here or go through all the 14 points, but you can see it all on my website, jimrubens.com. A little bit of background. I got up to New Hampshire, went to Dartmouth College. I dropped out after finishing my major, which is a chemistry major, and I proceeded to start and run 10 small businesses. I really loved business, and I retired when I was in my early 40s. After about half of them succeeded and half of them failed, I learned a tremendous amount about how to run business, and hire employees, and deal and navigate through the world. And then I decided to run for state senate. I'd never held office before, and I decided, why not go for the gold and run against the second most powerful person in the state of New Hampshire, who turned out to be the Senate president, who lived in the same district I did, Senate District 5. I interviewed him with three other people. We got him in a small room like this. He did show up in a small room, and we interviewed him for about 2 hours, and I discovered that I thought I could do a better job than he did, and I wound up winning that office. And I made some big promises to the people in the state. I promised to get Senate Bill 2 voting passed into law, which at the time is all Australian ballot voting, so you can vote on your town and school district budgets in the privacy of the voting booth. And I got that done my first year in office. And I also promised to have some type of school choice, because I believe in freedom. And I got the charter school law. I wrote it, researched it myself, and I had to explain it to people, and it was vigorously opposed. Both Senate Bill 2 voting and charter schools were vigorously opposed by, at that time, the establishment. Had to persuade a lot of Republicans, had to persuade a handful of Democrats to get the votes in the House and Senate, got the charter school a bill passed my second year in office. I launched discussion on electricity competition. That took a lot of explaining in my third year in office. I wrote the state's victim restitution law, which required me to navigate with four different agencies in the state. So I can get stuff done. I've been fighting my entire time after I left the state senate. I've been fighting against the establishment, if you want to call it that, and winning most of the time. I led this grand state coalition against expanded gambling for 10 years and defeated crony capital casinos in the state. 10 years running, never thought it could be done. So where are we now? And why does this apply? Well, right now we're at the point, two mile markers that I like to talk about that tell us where we are right now. Sorry for your cameras. It's okay if I walk around. Mile marker number one is a poll that came out about 2 years ago when I was running in 2014, and hemorrhoids were polling higher than Congress. Let's get it. This is true. Hemorrhoids were polling at 11% favorability. In other words, mostly unfavorable, and Congress was polling at 7%. Well, now they're about tied. So that's mile marker number one. We've got Congress and Washington that the people of America don't think is doing the work. And if you look at our primaries here in our two states, you see the extent of the desire for some very, very significant change in Washington. And And biomarker number two is what I was just talking about, is our primaries here in the state in February. We saw the anti-establishment candidate, Bernie Sanders and Donald Trump on the D and the R side, both of them won by landslides. These are the candidates that the establishment and the two parties did not want. So this bears on what we need to do right now in our party. We are at a point, if we're going to resolve our nation's problems, which we got to do, and if we're going to start doing what people want in America, we need to start solving the problems, we're going to need a political realignment. And it's uncomfortable for the establishment. And Ronald Reagan made things uncomfortable for the establishment in 1976 and 1980. Very uncomfortable. And what it did for our party when he won, we embraced the change that he brought to us. And it made our party bigger. Our Republican Party was bigger because we brought in people that weren't in our party before. And we got things done, like the Berlin Wall came down. We defeated Soviet communism. Big, big agenda items. Fixed. And it only got done because our party said, we're going to embrace the demand for change among the people. And that's exactly what I'm looking at in my own election right now. I'm running against the establishment, the other candidate, the incumbent. And I'm running for the other reason, which is to build solutions that will draw a lot more people to our party that are premised on two big principles. Number one is the principle that our party should stand for, which is small government and more freedom. That's principle number one. We can build solutions on those principles. And principle number two is work in Washington, policy making in Washington that is not bought and paid for. Okay, the public understands. When Donald Trump said, I'm not bought by those people down there, people cheered. When Bernie Sanders says, I take only small donations, and people cheered. The American public understands that it's a transactional, corrupt, crony capitalist system we've got in Washington, and it's why people are so frustrated. Why can't we get the tax code fixed? Why can't we get the regulations dialed back? Because the system pays for it to be like that. It's a system of bribery and extortion. So we need to pick up on the second theme. Not only do we need to build solutions based on liberty and small government, we need to build confidence and trust in the American people, that the people we sent to Washington are working. And it comes to my slogan in my campaign, make Washington work for Americans, not for the crony capitalists and the special interests down there. So I'm going to illustrate what this will look like in four big issues where I contrast myself with the incumbent and contrast myself with business as usual in Washington, and we'll fix problems. And problem number one is jobs in this country. Americans are under really pretty serious financial pressure. On the cover of The Atlantic magazine about 2 weeks ago, right on the cover, the average, a middle-class person with his pockets out like this, the average family in America cannot put $400 together for an emergency. Wages have gone down, inflation-adjusted wages have gone down 7% over the past 15 years. The cost of living is up 35%, and I'm talking medical care, food, housing, fuel, and it's put pressure on American families. So what are we going to do about it? And I go back to one of my 14-point plans on my website, jimrubens.com. I'll just talk about three of them that Republicans have been talking about for a long time, and three of them that Republicans need to talk about. The three of them we've been talking about for decades. Fix the tax code. Why can't we do it? Because lobbyists who can get down to Washington want the tax code complicated like this. What does that do when you have a complicated tax code? It means that the rates on everyone who can't afford $1,000 an hour lobbyists in Washington has to pay a higher rate. I say, simplify the tax code, bring the rates down. Problem number two, and how long have we heard Republicans talking about this? Dial back the regulations. We've got to do this. So I'm proposing that every 15 years, all the regulations sunset in a rotating cycle and come back to Congress, be re-looked at if they're redundant, if they're not necessary, if they don't protect the public health and safety, if they're too complicated for small businesses, then simplify them and Congress votes up or down. Congress has abdicated far too much power to the regulatory state, and it's burying small business. I've got a lot of experience in this. For the first time in American history, for the past 8 years, we have more businesses dying than being born. So dial back the regulatory state. So those are a couple things, three things that we need to do. Tax code. We need to reduce the corporate tax rate. It's the highest in the world. We're driving business offshore. We can bring that back by simplifying the corporate tax code. Things that are more uncomfortable within our party. And This comes from the message of Bernie Sanders and Donald Trump. We got to stop trade deals that are bad for Americans. Okay, we've theoretically free and fair trade is a great thing, but what we've seen over the past 20 years, we've seen massive hemorrhaging trade deficits, $500 billion a year being sucked out of the country, and with that money goes the jobs, and with it is going lower wages. So we need trade deals that result in a fair exchange of merchandise so that we can trade and it comes out equal. What some other country does well, we can buy that, that's good for consumers. What we do well, other companies buy. So we need fair trade deals. I differ with the incumbent, Kelly Ayotte, on this matter. She's for TPP, I'm not in favor of it. We've got to be thinking about American job people, people who need jobs. And that's different than what Republicans have done in the past. It's what the message of the people who are disenfranchised from our political system want. Issue number two that will be more uncomfortable for our party is open borders and amnesty. The incumbent, Kelly Ayotte, said that she would not vote for amnesty, and she goes ahead and goes to Washington, and votes for the Gang of Eight open borders amnesty deal. Now, what does that do for people in New Hampshire? That bill, if it would have passed, would have added 3 million more immigrants per year to the U.S. population. Right now, we're adding about 1 million per year. Why did the Gang of Eight people write it like that? I can't tell you for certain, but I can tell you what it would have done. It would have further driven down wages. When you massively flood the market with low-wage people, okay, what happens? You drive wages down. And we've got to stop this, okay? Our party has got to get on the side of regular Americans. Issue number three are these H-1B visas, okay? Senator Ayotte has, on multiple occasions, voted and advocated tripling the number of H-1B visas. This impacts technical workers in our state. You've probably seen these stories of Kodak workers, Eversource workers being forced to train their H-1B visa replacements. And what happens then? You're getting $125,000 an hour jobs, sufficient to employ people to raise families, buy a house, buy a car, pay their medical bills, have a retirement, replaced with foreign Indians, typically, at half that wage, okay? She is in favor of that stuff. I'm opposed to that stuff, okay? Because we've got to be thinking about Americans who can't get lobbyists in Washington again. So that's the jobs picture. Issue number two, where I sharply differ from the incumbent and my opponent, is on the fact that our country's bankrupt. And we are the Republican Party, right? We're supposed to be the party of fiscal responsibility. We're supposed to be the party that is careful with the dollar, okay? The last two budgets, Cromnibus and Omnibus, my opponent, the incumbent, voted for these two things. These are Obama's budgets, added $1.5 trillion to the national debt. This is just in the last 18 months. This is off the radar, it's off the map if you're a Republican. And if we vote for people who vote for this stuff, you know what you're gonna get? You're gonna get more of it. We have got to come to our senses fiscally in this country. And it means we've got to do what the New Hampshire legislature does, which is balance priorities. Stop the pork. Stop the crony capitalism. It's all got to end. And across the budget. Otherwise, we're looking at some kind of, we're going to go to negative interest rates. We're going to wind up with what Creed did, reaching into your bank account, taking money out. The government has, and our Congress, they know no limits. So we've got to elect people who will stop doing this. It means basic, core Republican value, fiscal responsibility. And issue number three that concerns me, and a sharp difference from where the incumbent is this whole concept of big government, big, powerful government impacting your life. We believe in more freedom. We believe in smaller government. We believe in pushing power back down to the states under the 10th Amendment and to the people, and not accreting power massively at the federal level. My opponent voted for the first time in American history, this thing called ESSA, Every Student Succeeds Act, which puts the federal government in control of state education plans. Now, states have to go down to Washington on bended knee, go down to the Department of Education and say, Mother, please, will you approve my state's education plan? This is unconstitutional. And the federal government doesn't even know how to run education. We've seen Goals 2000. We've seen... these wave after wave of federal programs now with Common Core,
None of them have worked. So why are Republicans voting for this stuff? The second issue where I differ with the incumbent is Obama's EPA global warming regulation. It's 600 some odd pages long, and it does nothing. And what it will do, again, is require states, because it's horrendously complex, and it'll force states, again, on bended knee, go down there to Washington, mother, please, will you allow us to have electricity generated in the way that we want to do it in our state? Okay? I differ with the incumbent. Kelly Ayotte and Maggie Hassan back Obama's EPA global warming plan. I oppose it because I oppose big government solutions to whatever problem it is. So these are three clusters of issues that show how we can fix problems. And by the way, I propose fixing energy in this country by getting rid of all the subsidies. It's all crony capitalism. The corn ethanol subsidies, okay? If you grow corn in Iowa, sure, you've got lobbyists down there. But what do we get in New Hampshire for that? We get higher food prices. We get our lawnmowers and boat motors wearing out faster. We get lower gas mileage, and you get starvation in Africa. Okay, this is foolish. So take away the energy subsidies. And again, I'm a free market guy. I've started a lot of businesses. I invest in startups. What are Americans really good at? We are really good at inventing stuff. And if we get businesses out of the business of going to Washington looking for handouts, then business can work on in energy. What we do, we will invent, as we've done with health sciences. Boston is a boom town because we lead the world in curing human beings. We're about to cure cancer. We've invented that, America. We will invent cheap, declining cost energy that we will sell to China and India, and the jobs will come home, and the export dollars will come our way instead of the other way, and we'll stop funding Russia, Saudi Arabia, and other entities that don't treat us very well. So that illustrates these principles of how we can fix problems with smaller government, more personal freedom, and we've got to be working for the American people again, jobs. So here's the good news about all this stuff. I've been down to Washington, and I've talked with the powers that be, and this is the big money question. Obviously, it takes millions to defeat Hassan. They've told me, Jim, you'd make a great senator. You can wrap your mind around issues, which I did when I was in the state senate, and I did when I was in business. We like the incumbent. If you win, all those millions of dollars will go to whoever wins this primary. And the reason for that is because the control of the U.S. Senate is at stake. So this race right here in New Hampshire is one of those that will determine whether the D's or the R's have majority control in the United States Senate. And what that does, what this good news gives you folks the power to do, it gives you the power to nominate a candidate that won't vote with the Democrats all the time. Just putting an R next to the name is not enough. If we believe in fiscal responsibility and freedom and limited government, you have the right and the obligation to vote for someone who will do this stuff. And you're free to do it because I'm in a better position to defeat Maggie Hassan than the incumbent. I can bring over these disaffected voters who are sick and tired of Washington crony capitalism and sold-out government. So, love to have your support. JimRubens.com. Happy to take questions. Thank you, folks, for coming. Sir?
Yeah, I guess it's more of a comment than a question, but it drives me insane that there's this bipartisanship that goes on with our leaders in, you know, in Congress and every place else, because when the Democrats are in power, they care not one whit about working with Republicans. But when the Republicans are in power, all of a sudden,
right,
now they want to play nice and be everybody together, and it's a bipartisanship. Yes. It's like, I don't get it. I don't understand why we would elect people that would want to do that.
There are two theories. You know, Republicans and Democrats are closely balanced in the country, and we're a purple state. And so the theory here in New Hampshire by what I call the establishment, and I don't want to be too disparaging, but it's that mindset that says we don't need to change very much. We need to sucker the voters one more time. They told us, give us the U.S. Senate in 2014. Remember that?
Mm-hmm.
We gave them the U.S. Senate. What's the first thing that goes up is the white flag. Right up, the white flag, all the way to the top of the poll. We're going to pass Obama's budget. And by God, they did it. And they drove us another $1.5 trillion into debt. Okay? So compromise and bipartisanship is good where there's agreement, but where there's fundamental differences between the parties, that's why we have two parties. It's why we're sitting in the room here.
And on some of the stuff, we've got to fight it out. We can't just vote for Obama's budgets. And the power of the, coming back to the budgets again, Congress has the power of the purse under the United States Constitution. Obama, the president, has the power to veto it. The Congress has the power to write budgetary laws. We have the power. If Republicans, as they do, control the U.S. Senate, all we need to do is vote like Republicans. Unfortunately, the last budget, the omnibus, stuffed with pork and crony capitalism and tax breaks, half of Republicans, including the incumbent that I'm running against, voted for it, but half didn't. Another five Republicans in that U.S. Senate will change things. That'll change things, and we can start acting like Republicans. Compromise when it's possible, that's a good thing, but when our principles are at stake, when the future of the country is at stake, when American workers are at stake, we gotta take sides.
Talks about the establishment. What do you think
the establishment is? It's the forces that don't really want to confront reality and change. Okay, again, I come back to the beginning. Americans want change in Washington. The 10% rating in Congress, okay? The primaries we just had. So the establishment of people, those are the people who are saying, we don't need to change. We can keep on doing just what we're doing, and we need to slick it up and maybe sell it a little bit different. Maybe put a new coat of paint on the thing. Put some lipstick on the pig. American public is beyond that now, okay? We, and I call myself American public because I vote like this myself. We've discovered that stuff is a lie. We've discovered we want fundamental change in Washington. That's why these two candidates won by landslides in our state. We're saying enough. So the establishment are the people that are saying business as usual, keep on doing what we're doing. Not only will that dissatisfy us, but it doesn't solve the country's problems. We've got to have new ideas. We've got to have fresh thinking. And we've got to stop this bought and paid for system in Washington that prevents Washington from serving the American people.
Thank you.
Yeah. So.
Now, besides being in New Hampshire politics, what do you think qualifies you for this position?
Well, I've been in small business. I've done a lot of that. I invest in startups.
Lemonade stand or something bigger?
Yeah.
Lemonade stand or something bigger?
Somewhere north of a lemonade stand. In some businesses, my first business, I was a junkie. Dropped out of college, and I went down to the dump, and it was at one of the Arab oil embargoes, and I couldn't get a job for the life of me, so I started dumps back when they were dumps, and they had burning piles, and I would go hack copper out of refrigerators, and I was able to earn $40 an hour. I was able to save enough money to buy my first investment property, and I mortgaged it. They got second mortgages on it twice, and I bought. I was one of the first 20 investors in a company that went public at $2 billion. Billion. And I did that by collecting copper. I was black every day. It's dirty work. And I learned how to work with my hands because I grew up in a suburban area, and so I learned how to work with my hands. And my other is I worked in the state senate. I got elected to the state senate, and I got stuff done. Big stuff. Bold. Controversial stuff that required fighting, and I got it done. And look at the charter schools in the state. There are 20 some odd of them in the state. The top testing school in the state, and I pat myself a little bit on the back, because most of the people around the school, it's the Academy of Science and Design over at Nashua. Top testing school in the state, and they're operating at a third the cost per student than our average public school is operating at. Top testing in the state, math and science, excellence. A third the cost, okay? It's showing how freedom can fix problems. Taxpayers are happier, parents are happier because you got choice for parents, and we're getting more advanced talent right here in our state. It's a good thing. So those are my two kinds of real world experience with my hands, management, investing, my work in the state senate.
Right,
right. So.
You know, we've heard your story over and over again from you, from others, day in, day out. So, why are you going to be the one we need? Why are you going to be the one that's going to go to Washington and do all these things for New Hampshire?
I mean, why won't I break promises like the others do? Is that what you're saying?
What?
Why won't I break promises like...
No, I don't want to call you a liar. I'm just saying that it just appears that we hear the stories over and over, and then you get to Washington, and is it the water, the air, or...
It's the $100 steak dinners, it's the asking key vacations.
What?
Say, yeah.
Why should we believe you're going to be
right? Yeah, that's right. two ways I can answer that that I hope satisfy you. Number one is what I did when I was in the state senate. I made some big promises in the state senate that required me to do stuff that got people agitated to get Senate Bill 2 voting passed. The unions, the municipal association, hated me, despised the idea, and it created intense friction. I did not back down. I wasn't insulting to anyone. I persuaded people. I organized people. So you have to stick to your principles. And I made promises when I ran for the state senate, and I kept those promises. I promised to return every single phone call from my constituents over my 4 years in the state senate, and by God, I did within 48 hours. Every phone call. I took calls at 3 in the morning. I didn't have a red phone, but it was people with serious problems. They were calling, you know, divorces and emotional disturbance, and I took those calls, and I did that. The second thing I can say is that I've made a promise right on my brochure here. I am not going to take the pension they gave me. I'm going to limit myself to 2 terms. By the way, I support term limits, limit to 2 terms. And I'm not going to become a lobbyist. Half of U.S. senators, when they leave office, become lobbyists, and they're paid $2 to $3 million a year. And it warps your thinking. The $100 state dinners, the people fawning at your feet, telling you how wonderful you are, and then bribing you with campaign money. I'm not going to do that, okay? I'm not in this for career. This country's on the edge. We're going over the edge in 3 different ways. You've seen Thelma and Louise. We're going in 3 ways over a cliff. We've got to deal with this stuff now. And if people that are running for office are not serious about fixing this country, if you're in it for career, if you're in it to be there in Washington, you can see how strongly I feel about this. I don't know. I can only, you know, the trust, I guess, can come from what I did in the state senate. And I'm not going to become a lobbyist. I've written it down. Not going to do it. I'm going to be down there not for the $100 steak dinners, not for the lobbyists giving me campaign bribes. I'm down there to fix the problems.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Sir.
Just a question. You mentioned a number of supported amendments to balance the budget. What are your thoughts on an Article 5 convention? Are groups on both sides of the spectrum pushing for this to amend the Constitution? It's a convention of the states.
Right.
There's a question whether or not the convention could run away. We could end up with a lot of new government granted rights. So what is your...
Between my election loss in September 2014 and about 4 months ago, I have been traveling around the country testifying to legislatures in the various states that have gradually been using the power under Article 5 of our United States Constitution. It's a power that's never been used before. And we know that Congress is drunk on debt. Okay? For my entire adult lifetime, I've heard politicians in both parties telling me they're going to balance the budget. Has it happened? It did happen once when Republicans got some backbone and we had 4 years of balanced budgets and we had some surpluses. But other than that time, Republicans have been voting for the pork. So the framers of our Constitution gave the people the power to amend the Constitution in a state-led fashion. Now, never been used. Constitution amended 27 times. There have been 300 constitutional amendment conventions in this country, both before our Constitution was ratified and at the state level. And in none of those 300 amending conventions did the conventioneers ever depart from the convention call, which is the resolution stating the purpose of the convention. All the resolutions we've seen have said, your job, delegates, is to work on fashioning language on that subject. Never once in 260 years have the delegates ever strayed from the resolution subject matter language.
Except for the original one where they created it.
They didn't do it there either. We've got to get into the weeds on this, but there were 2 steps that led to our constitutional convention. It didn't even happen in that case. So I know there's concern about this. There are 29 states now that have signed up of the necessary 34 for a balanced budget amendment. In our state, we're one of the 29 states. In 2012, our state adopted a balanced budget resolution. And the other safeguard, which is the biggest one, is it takes 38 states to pass any constitutional amendment that might be proposed. And that means that 13 state legislatures can kill any proposed amendment. So we have the toughest to amend constitution in the free world. And it means that there's got to be massive, massive consensus. And there is around term limits and balanced budgets. 85% of the public want it. Congress will not give it to us. That's why the framers put this means into the Constitution for us to, they imagined that one day George Mason, 2 days before the end of the convention, said there's a problem in this Constitution. We better give the states the power to fix things that Congress won't fix if they become corrupt. Too long to answer, sorry about that. I'm very...
You're optimistic about it.
Well, I can tell you people who support this power. Abraham Lincoln, Dwight Eisenhower, Ronald Reagan, Justice Scalia. All support and think that the Article 5 process, the state-led process, is safe. Any more questions?
So what years did you serve?
94 to 98.
Okay.
Served 94, I ran for governor in 98. In 2000, I chaired the state platform committee, and we had the first platform that was more detailed. Growing out of that platform that I led consensus on developing, it was a much more precise platform, and it led to the formation of the House Republican Alliance, and they began measuring votes in the House against the Republican Party platform for the first time. So again, controversial. People that didn't want to be measured didn't like the idea, but it led to the House, it led to voters being able to determine whether your candidates, you know, against the platform. Then I ran for, I worked for Gordon Humphrey. I was in 02. I was his chief policy advisor and spokesman when he ran for governor. After that, I went back in business a bit. I led the Granite State Coalition Against Expanded Gambling, as I mentioned, as a volunteer work for which the unit leader named me Citizen of the Year in 2013. That's some of the stuff I've done. A lot of volunteer work.
Thank you.
Yeah.
One last question.
Yeah.
You seem like you've been very successful and very productive.
Yes.
Why do you want to involve yourself into political arena at a time like this?
Well, look at the state of the country. We're bankrupt, number one. Our prosperity is slipping away from us, middle-income people. And this is another issue I didn't get into, we have, since the Berlin Wall fell, we have a succession of failed nation-building wars that have made us less safe. We have got to get a better national security policy than Hillary and Bill Clinton have brought, and unfortunately the incumbent Kelly Ayotte is cheerleading Hillary Clinton's failed nation-building wars. The most recent two are Libya, Syria, Iraq, spreading terrorism. We've got to have a better way to make us safe, again on my website. So these are extremely serious, tough issues that we've got to get our arms around. Why do I want to do this? Why do people volunteer for the fire department? Same thing. You love your country.
You get back to the community.
You love your country, that's it. You go down and serve, and then you go back home again. That's the way it should be. When it was a swamp down there, that's what people used to do. Now they got $100 an hour steak dinners, and they want to stay there forever. So.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you. Appreciate
you. Say one more thing. I'd love to, if you folks think I make sense, so you can go to my website, you can put some donations in, you can sign up to volunteer. Sarah's there in the corner. Sarah's helping on the campaign, political director.
Yes, also, if anyone wants a yard sign, we have yard signs, and if anyone knows anyone who also wants to intern with us this summer, we also have intern applications as well.
Thank you. Thank you very much, folks. Really appreciate it.